First question is that when I look at your previous works and I think about them, at the beginning you were most interested in realism, and then with Modest Reception you became more interested in absurd comedy and kind of philosophical inquiry, and 15 Kilo of Cherries is kind of remarriage comedy, and White Dragon Arrives is a kind of postmodern pastiche. I know that you always think or have reflection about your works, and you do most of your work based on research. I'm just wondering how you could define the genre of this film. Is it kind of tragic comedy? Is it kind of absurd comedy?
It's a black comedy, I think. It's laughing at something that's tragic. That's how we define it.
Okay, and there is no tradition of genre or this kind of cinema in Iranian cinema. It's very hard for Iranian directors to find, for example, a good example compared to, for example, what we have in American tradition. I'm just wondering if you have, if this causes a problem, or if it is a concern when you try to create a genre.
You don't necessarily look for predecessors in your own country's cinema necessarily. I mean, why would I do that? I look to all kinds of traditions, and you know, black comedy films, there's lots of those. They don't have to be Iranian for me to use them as some kind of a support for my own
films. Leila Hatami, the characters in the film, because by killing Leila Hatami, I think that the genre of films has changed. It's becoming from comedy to tragic. It's very hard to not have any sympathy with the Leila Hatami character.
That's right.
And she was not a director in the film, because you mostly killed the director in the film. So I'm just curious if you have...
we wanted something completely unexpected and sudden, and, you know, we wanted a shock.
Okay.
So we set it up so that directors are being killed, but so you don't ever expect that character to be targeted. But then she is, and the rules of the game change, and you know.
Okay, and the first director that you killed were mostly famous directors, Bani Etemad, and well-known directors, Ne'matullah. But after that, the directors or people who got killed are not, we don't know them. Is it because it was difficult to ask the same person to play?
No, because it was a fictional character. We were going to switch from reality to fiction. And so, you know, we begin with real directors and then we move to imaginary ones.
I like a lot the music and the role that the music played, because the main directors always wear a t-shirt with the name of a band or something on it, and he'll listen to the music, he plays with guitars, and he imitates that he's playing with guitar. So music is not something that just helps the audience feel the movie. It seems to have a kind of function or character. I'm just wondering if...
Well, that's true. I mean, we were trying to present a grown-up baby. And so for a 50-year-old man to wear, you know, heavy metal t-shirts and have heavy metal posters on his walls, immediately gives you a visual cue that he's a child in a sense. You know, he still has attachments to his childhood interests. That was basically the idea of that was the main idea. But also, you know, heavy metal music in an Iranian comedy, that's new. Well, that's good.
And there is a feeling that you somehow resent. The directors in the film resent the Iranian culture, that they don't like their intellectuals, or they like to see them in a very bad situation, to feel sympathy towards them. Just curious if this is something that you want to say with this book, because you are trying to criticize this type of culture, this type of ressentiment that exists in Iranian.
I don't think that's the case. There is a certain amount of resentment toward what is called the masses. So like a faceless voice that has no identity and is kind of attacking you in this aggressive way. There's some defense against that kind of attack, you know, cyber attacks or cyber lynchings and things like this. So there's that. It's a story of a person who's unable to deal with his own audience, right? He's kind of having this problem connecting with them, because he's not working, and then he he's being attacked by them. So it's that's where one of the tensions of the film lies.
Thoughts or ideas about why cinema is so important in contemporary, so is it this Orange culture?
I have no idea, but it is important. Fans of cinema are the most, I mean, aside from rock and roll, they're the most diehard fans you can find. They become very attached to, you know, film stars and certain films, and they become stalkers sometimes. They become aggressive. They demand things from you that you haven't delivered, so they feel like you owe them something. This all happens, and this is all real. And it's very potent dramatically, so you can actually use it, as I have in a story.
About your relationship with custom designer, is it you suggested her, or if you can explain a little bit?
No, I mean, we've been working together for a long time. Like, as you say, it's the fourth time we've worked together, so we basically know what's going on. I mean, she already has a sense of what I like, and I have a sense of what she can bring to the film that surprises me. That's basically what I want from her, is for her to change my mind. I suggest something and she says, no, let's do this instead, and it's a much more interesting idea. So I always count on all of my collaborators, but especially design people, to change my mind and make it, to surprise me with their suggestions, and therefore make the film surprising to me.
I think this is your second collaboration with Hossein Majuni.
Hassan.
It's Hassan Majuni in Abadan, I think. He had a very short
run.
Can-on, yes. And you talk a lot about that you couldn't imagine this film without him. I'm just curious if you can say more about this. What was the reason that you think that he fits perfectly?
Primarily because Hassan is a... That character carries the entire film. He's in every single scene, and it's all about him. And he has to go through all kinds of trials and tribulations. It's a very difficult role to play. And I needed someone who I could be sure would commit to the role and really pull it off, because it was very difficult for him. And I didn't really know anyone else who had all these qualities that I wanted him to have and be as strong and committed to the idea of acting. Hassan is unique in that sense. So when the idea came to me and I realized how important this character is going to be, then I thought to myself, if Hassan doesn't do it, then it's impossible to do.
And how was the collaboration with Leila Hatami? I think you worked with her in Man, as an actor. You never worked as a director with
her? No, we never worked together before. I never directed her before. But she's a very old friend of mine. She's a childhood friend of mine. And so we've known each other all our lives. And so it was actually very easy, because we know each other so well, and we respect each other both professionally and in life. So it was the easiest thing to do. It was very simple.
I'm asking this question because I think that she played just once time in comedy in B. Pooley, if I'm right.
That's right.
But this was something, I guess, very new in her career.
Well, the thing about Leila is that she is herself very funny and very warm.
Okay.
And for some reason, in all her films, she's presented as this kind of depressed, cold person. And I've always wondered why people don't use this fantastic feature of her character, which is her warmth, and sort of bring that out. So we tried that, and I encouraged her very much to open up and be warm-hearted, and it worked.